गुड मॉर्निंग चिल्ड्रन, वेलकम टू स्टैंडर्ड 10। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट आवर सिलेबस ऑफ इंग्लिश लैंग्वेज। एज एवरीबॉडी इज वेल अवेयर दैट आवर फर्स्ट लेसन इट इज actually a poem, and it is where the mind is without fear. As you are looking here on the board, you can look here, it is written by Rabindranath Tagore. You might be well aware of the fact that this poem is one of the largest read poems in English literature, one of the largest read poems. But before we go to the actual poem, I would like to ask you a few questions. Children, you have learnt in history that before independence, British used to rule our country, right? Yes, of course everybody knows. And that period is just like we were slaves, though not in literal terms, but many such things were there when all the Indians, irrespective of caste, class, religion, social status, were suffering because of this empire, right? So they were doing a lot on their part, just like there was a freedom struggle, satyagraha, and so many things. Now the question is there for you. Suppose you were there, born before 1947, living in that India when British were ruling here, what would you have prayed for yourself, for the country, or the people of our nation? Yes, yes, of course. We may have prayed that we should get freedom, we should be free from the empire of this British Empire. Yes, apart from that, we should have aspired for good education. Then we would have asked for food, cloth, shelter, and many such things. Yes, we understand. Ordinary people are always having ordinary wishes and desires. But children, you know, the great people like Rabindranath Tagore, they are great because their way of thinking is great. They don't think of bread and butter. They think of the country and the people and the nation and the progress of the nation. And when they pray, they are not like us. They pray for the humanity, they pray for the world, they pray for us. Rabindranath Tagore, before we go to this actual poem, let us have this brief introduction of this poet, great poet Rabindranath Tagore. You might be knowing that Rabindranath Tagore is a Bengali poet. He belongs to Bengal. I'm giving you his brief. Just have a look here. About the poet. Name Rabindranath Tagore. Birth 7th May 1861 and died 7th August 1841.
of course in Kolkata, then part of British Empire, and now in West Bengal. He is also known by the name Bhanu Singh Thakur or Thakur. People there call him by the name Bhonita. And in the freedom struggle, he is also known by the name Gurudev. Rabindranath Tagore's personality is such that he is a poet, he was a poet, a musician, artist, and Ayurveda researcher. And then he has written a poem by the name Gitanjali. In 1910, for that poem, he got the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1913. And thus he became the first non-European or first Indian who got this award. You might be knowing that from this Gitanjali only we have taken that Jana Gana Mana, our national anthem. Actually it is written in Bengali, but later it is also translated in English. Rabindranath Tagore has written the national anthem of two nations. Number one, India, and number two, Bangladesh. And there in Bangladesh, Amar Sonar Bangla is the national anthem of Bangladesh. Then we know that this poet, there are so many things to be said about Rabindranath Tagore, but right now this much introduction of the poet is enough. Now about this poem, where the mind is without fear. What the poet has explained here, as I mentioned earlier, he got the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1913. Nobel Prize for Literature. In 1913, then India was ruled by the British. In Russia, there was communism. In America, there was the racism. In short, the whole world was suffering with one or the other problem. And there was a kind of fear all across the globe. There was no freedom at all. In such a situation, Rabindranath has written this poem, which became very, very meaningful. Though it is written for India alone, but it has a universal appeal. So it is for the whole world. What is the title of the poem? Where the mind is without fear. If our mind is without fear, it means that we are free and we can do the things that we like. So Rabindranath Tagore in this poem has prayed Almighty for the freedom of India, our country, India,
and he also appeals for social common educational and economic freedom and economic freedom of our nation. Our nation, India.
Let us go to the poem. Let's come to page number 2 and let's go for that warming up first. See, there are two columns, column A and column B. In column A, there are such terms, some terms. In column B, there are such, their meanings are given. Now just guess by reading okay, which should be the meaning of these terms. Number one, humanism. Now read column B. You will find that E suits that meaning, a rationalistic outlook towards humans rather than a divine or supernatural one. Now see the next one, patriotism. C, option C, quality of being patriot, patriotic, vigorous, support for one's country. Then third one is international. Anybody can guess here? That is state or process of being international. Liberalism, that is holding liberal views. And now the fifth one, everybody can answer. Can you? Yeah, of course. That one, remaining one, and that is A, concern about an action aimed at protecting the environment. Okay. Children, when we learn a poem, children, when we learn a poem, you come across different kinds of poems. You might have observed, if you are interested in literature, there are few poems with 14 lines. 14 lines poem. Then you might have see 5 line poems. It is, some poems are having rhymes, some poems are without rhymes. It is, so broadly poems are of different kinds. Few kinds we are going to learn here. See page number 2, point 2, it is given here. Poems in English are of different types. Number one, given that point, S-O-N-N-E-T. Yes, it is pronounced as sonnet. And you know what is a sonnet? A poem of 14 lines, given here down, point number 3. A poem of 14 lines is called a, yes, sonnet. Then second one, limerick, L-I-M-E-R-I-C-K, that is read as limerick. It is read as limerick. And limerick, what is limerick? Limerick is a poem. Point number 8, a 5-line short funny poem with a rhyme scheme AABBA. You are well aware of that rhyme scheme and pattern of rhyme scheme, so no need to explain. So a poem with 5 line, short funny poem having rhyme scheme AABBA is called a limerick. Understood? 14 line poem is a sonnet and 5 line poem is a yes, limerick. Then there is BALLAD. It is read as balud. It is read as balud. And what is balud? A short story poem with a message. A short story poem with a message, point number 2, is called a balud. The next one is elegy. Sorry, ELEGY. You will read that way, but actually the sound of this word is elegy. Elegy, okay? Elegy. Okay? Understood? Elegy. And what is elegy? Point number 7. A sad poem lamenting death of a loved one. Understood? Okay. The next one is free verse. Everybody is aware of this free verse. And free verse, point number 5, a poem with no uniformity of rhyme, rhythm, etc. Okay. Then next one is epic. E-P-I-C. Epic. E-P-I-K. Okay, epic. This one. So what is epic? Epic means a long story poem, often mythical. And you can give the examples like Ramayana, Mahabharat. These are epics only. Then L-Y-R-I-C. In cinemas, you always see the lyricist or lyric. So that is lyric. And lyric is a song-like poem. Lyric means a song-like poem. Then there are poems which are humorous. Point number 9. A poem written just to create humor. That is called humorous. Okay. And the last one is, see here, IDYLL. It is called idyll. And what is idyll? A poem set in picturesque rustic background. Background of a rural part, rural area, that is called idyll. So these 9 kinds are given here. You might have understood. But this poem that we are going to learn here today is neither of these kinds, but is a prayer. It is a prayer for the Almighty. Prayer for the Almighty for the freedom of our nation, our country, India. Yes. Yes. Come to page number 3. The actual poem. First of all, I'll read out this poem. Just listen carefully. Where the mind is without fear and the head is held high, where knowledge is free, where the world has not been broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls, where words come out from the depth of truth, where tireless striving stretches its arms towards perfection, where the clear stream of reason has not lost its way into the dreary desert sand of dead habit, where the mind is led forward by thee into ever-widening thought and action, into that haven of freedom. My father, let my country awake. Rabindranath Tagore.
Let us see first line. What the poet says, where the mind is without fear. Two points are there in this first line. Mind, the poet prays the Almighty that it should be without fear. And second, head, held high. In this first line, poet is praying Almighty that the Indians, our countrymen, should be free and their mind should be without fear. You might understand कि unless your mind is without fear, you can't develop, you can't progress, you can't do anything. Just for example, suppose you are always in the fear of something. You are afraid that you will be beaten, you will be jailed, you will be troubled. So can you think anything of your better future? Can you do anything that can do something good for your future? No, of course not. So to develop, it is required that our mind should be free. And in that period, when British were ruling India, Indians' minds were not without fear. Everybody was afraid of being caught or put to jail or being troubled for something or the other. And therefore, the first thing that he is asking to God is, our mind should be without fear. Now, second point in this first line that he is asking is, the head is held high. It means there should be self-respect, which was lacking in those days. And unless you are having, or we are having, or anybody is having that self-respect, he can't hold his head high. That is understood. And therefore, these things are the sign, if your mind is not fear and your head is held high, it means these are the signs of free nation or freedom. You got freedom, or you are having that freedom. Okay, so that first line, what the poet says, where the mind is without fear and the head is held high. Okay, in this line, see, the sound of W and H is repeated. Where, without, and head, held high. Sound of H is repeated. You know, such kind of repetition of a consonant sound is called alliteration. So this first line, the figure of speech used by the poet is alliteration. What figure of speech the poet has used here? Yes, alliteration. Let's go to the second line. Dear children, as I told you, our second line is where knowledge is free. Now see, what Rabindranath Tagore is asking from the Almighty that knowledge is free. You know, before independence, that is before 1947, knowledge is not given to all. It is only a privilege of a few, rich people. So there was illiteracy prevailing in the country. There was no knowledge, and you might be well aware of the fact that knowledge is the base of progress. And the British, they don't want the Indians to gain that knowledge. And so, his feelings about what we Indians feel, Rabindranath Tagore had written in this line, where knowledge is free. Now then, let's go to the third line, where the world has not been broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls. Very meaningful line. Very important line. Because in this third line, the poet has used the word fragments. You know, fragments means pieces. India, where the world has not been broken up into fragments. And now he explained these fragments. What are these fragments? Of narrow domestic walls. Now, what is narrow domestic wall? Explained down here in the meaning. Can you see this? Division on the basis of religion, caste, class and color in societies and between countries of the world. Now see children, in those days the world was divided into those narrow, means not wide, domestic walls. Means the world has built up walls between religions, means fight between religions, just like Hindu, Muslim or Savarn, Dalit. Then the division on the best of caste, Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Kshudra, etc. Then division on the base of class, high class, mid class, lower class, below poverty line. Then color in societies, color, division on the base of color, that is white and black. You might be knowing, yesterday in America, a white policeman has killed a black person, and therefore there are protests all across America. People are putting fire to many places, to many buildings. So there is a lot of unrest. You might be knowing, because of this color, the South African Indian cricket team was banned for almost 21 years for this difference in color, means black and white. And later they were allowed to play again in 1991, that international cricket, South Africa. Okay. So division on the basis of religion, caste, class, color, and so many other factors in the world. So this is the division, and the poet says, I don't want a world which has been broken up into fragments on these basis of religion, caste, class, color, etc. And the same is true about our country, India. Our country was also suffering the same problem. The British were ruling India by divide and rule. By the rule, divide and rule. They were making Indians, and especially the largest population here, the Hindus and the Muslims, to fight with one another, and they used to rule the country. And Rabindranath Tagore is exactly saying the same thing. Apart from this, there was Brahman and Dalit, you know, differences were there, and the Brahmins used to treat the Dalits or the Mahars very, very badly, harshly. Okay, so considering all these things together, the poet is saying, where the world has not been broken up into fragments by narrow domestic wars. In this third line, as we have seen in the first line, the sound of W is repeated. See, where the world, and then again being broken, sound of B, means sound of W and sound of B is repeated, and so everybody can say the figure of speech used in this line number 3 is yes, yes, alliteration. Very good. Let's move to line number 5. Where words come out from the depth of truth. Where words come out from the depth of truth. See children, what is the meaning of depth of truth? The meaning of depth of truth is sincerity of heart. Dil se nikle hai, nikle hai alfaz. What is the meaning of that? The British people, they used to promise so many things, but those words were only there on their lips. They never fulfilled their promises. Whatever they commit, they never act on that. It means, whatever words come out in those days from the mouth of these rulers, those words were not out from the depth of truth. So there was no truth. And if there is no truth, there can't be justice. And the poet is feeling very deeply that there is no justice, and so there should be that sincerity of intention, sincerity of heart whenever you say anything. And this prayer is not only for the British rulers, but is for all the Indians, that everybody should be sincere with the actions and deeds. Here also alliteration is used. Let's go to line number 6. Where tireless striving stretches its arms towards perfection. See this slide.
Where tireless striving stretches its arms towards perfection.
See, for your help,
here given tireless striving, footnotes. It means continuous efforts and struggle, and stretches its arm meaning aims at achieving a goal.
What the poet says? The poet inspires the Indians, inspire the people who aspire for freedom, that there should be continuous efforts and struggle, and their struggle and effort should be with the aim to achieve a goal. And then in those days, the goal was to achieve freedom and to achieve perfection in everything, to progress. Okay. Here, again, sound of S is repeated, so alliteration is there. Apart from that, the poet has said, tireless striving stretches itself. It means striving or efforts is given the human quality of stretching arms. It means those attempts are personified here. It means the same line is having one more figure of speech, that is personification. You know personification? When a non-living thing is supposed to do the thing that is being done by a living thing is called personification. Next. Where the clear stream of reason has not lost its way. In this line, clear stream is compared with reason. Clear stream. Clear stream is compared with reason. You know reason, sound base for something. And therefore, this kind of comparison, without using the word like, so or as, is called metaphor. So using this metaphor, comparing clear stream with reason, the poet is conveying the message that this reason has not lost its way into the dreary desert. Into the dreary desert sand. And it is compared with dead habit. It means again metaphor. Direct comparison. So what is dreary desert sand? Gloomy, sad. Desert, you know, sand, you know. So, in these two lines, what the poet is saying? Where the clear stream of reason means where the power of thinking about something as right or wrong, good or bad, that should be intact. Dead habits. About dead habits, the poet is saying, old traditional rituals and customs that are harmful. So there, in that India before independence, there were many dead habits. There were many dead habits in India, just like some old traditions and rituals and customs, and those were very harmful for the society. For example, just like you can say sati pratha, then child marriage, then many other such things. So, and there are many customs and traditions which were harmful for the society. So the poet is saying ki our nation, my India, or the Indian people and their thinking, the way of thinking should not be lost into what? That dreary desert sand of dead habit. It means people should think logically what is right and what is wrong. They shouldn't follow blind superstitions. They shouldn't follow the things which were harmful for the society. I remember, for example, still in Tamil Nadu, there is one way that a small child is buried in that pit or grave at the signal of that priest, and the whole family was there for a few minutes, and it was taken as, you can say, Shav Yatra. Means they go in that way, they bury means they just put something just like thorns and something, just cover that grave, and after a few minutes they take him out or take her out, the child take her out, and they think if by doing that the child could be saved by so many things, so many means diseases. Then you can also say about Devadasi Pratha, Devadasi Jallikattu. So there are many examples. Devadasi is still are there. So these are dead habits, and the poet warned that instead of all these dead habits, our nation should have sound base for doing things, and they should be educated, and they should be able to think properly for what is right, and they should be able to judge what is right and what is wrong, what should be done and what should be avoided. So in this line, into the dreary desert sand of dead habit, as I said, dreary desert sand is compared to dead habit, so it is metaphor. Then sound of D and D, dreary desert, sound of D is repeated, therefore alliteration is there. And one more thing is there, and that is sand of dead habit. So these are the figures of speech used in this slide. Okay, let's move to the last part of the poem, where the poet is praying Almighty, where the mind is led forward by thee. Very important words, mind is led forward by thee. First let us discuss this word thee. Thee is old English word for you. It is old English. They are also called archaic words. Archaic words. So it is used for you. You means here God. So what the poet saying? Where the mind led forward by thee. Means my mind, my thoughts, my actions, whatever I do must be guided by you. And when something is guided by God, it is never wrong. It is never harmful for the society, harmful for the people. God. So therefore, when the mind is led for prayer, so he prays God the Almighty that my mind or the mind of the people of living the country or the mind of Indians or the mind of the people who are reading this poem should be led forward by thee. It means everybody should think logically and what is beneficial for the society, what is beneficial for the country, what is beneficial for the whole world. So he needs the guidance from Almighty. And next slide he says, into ever widening thought and action. What he says? Ever widening. See the meaning here?
Into ever widening thought and action. See here. Ever widening, forever broadening one's outlook. It means that outlook of me should go on increasing and increasing and increasing and developing and developing.
And unless and until my way or my outlook keeps broadening, I can't progress. My family can't progress, my society, my community, my country, my world can't progress. So he says, my thought and action. Two words he used here, using here, thought and action. Whenever we say about anything, we say about thought and action. My thoughts are and whatever my actions are, all the thoughts and actions, good thinking and good actions must be ever widening. It should go on being better and better and better and better. And if they go on being better and better, the society progress and the country and the whole world will get benefits, benefits and benefits only. And the last line, the poet says, into that heaven of freedom. Here, heaven of freedom is in bold italics. Heaven of freedom. See the meaning of heaven of freedom? Condition of total freedom of good thoughts, good words and good deeds while respecting those of others. This condition is referred to by the poet as heaven of freedom. Means, what is heaven of freedom? Where there will be total freedom of thoughts. In that India where British were ruling before 1947, there were no freedom for good thoughts, no freedom for good words, no freedom for good deeds, and no respect for others. So children, what the poet is asking from the Almighty, that we or the people of India should be guided by the Almighty and their thought and action must go on ever widening and widening and widening. It means there should be understanding. There should be understanding for one another's values, opinions, beliefs, customs, etc. There should be understanding between religions, point of view, and so many things. Okay. And the last line, the poet says, into that heaven of freedom.
See this heaven of freedom. Heaven of freedom, this term is written in bold letters and it means condition of total freedom of good thoughts, good words and good deeds while respecting those of others.
See, this is called ever widening thought and action. So the poet is praying the Almighty that if such will be the condition, what is the condition? Where the mind will be without fear, the head will be held high, knowledge will be free, world will not be broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls, where the people are sincere and truthful, the words coming out from the depth of their hearts, they are striving for perfection and their logical thinking has not lost its way. Considering all these points together, the poet is saying, if such is the place, then that place will be a haven of freedom for me, for my people, for my country, for the whole world. And further in the same line he says, my father. Here F for the term father is written capital. And here father means God or Almighty. Let my country awake. And he says, his saying is, let my country awake, just like my country is sleeping. And country here meaning people of the country. That is, country stands for the people of the country, and therefore here the figure speech used in the last line is select a king. Select the king. It means country is compared with the people of the country. And one more is there, when he addresses father, my father, it means the poet is addressing the Almighty. So one more figure of speech is there, and that is apostrophe. You might be knowing, when a thing which is not present or absent is addressed and personified, that is called apostrophe. So two figures which are used in this line, one is Seneca and another is apostrophe. And then he said, let my country awake. It means the poet expects or prays the Almighty that my country should get that freedom of my dreams, of our dreams, and therefore it will be a haven of freedom for we people, for the country. Thank you very much.